ready to listen to Antoine about reduced order binary decision diagrams as compacted tree structures.
Okay, thank you, Alain. This is a joint work with Julien Clément from Normandy University. And this is a study about data structures for Boolean functions. And we will study these data structures from a combinatorial point of view. In fact, binary decision diagrams has been developed in the late 80s, and they were very useful in practice, in particular in automatic verification, like in model checking, or in Boolean circuits synthesis. So they are very useful in practice, but in fact, the combinatorics under these structures has not been so much studied. So, in fact, we are not able even to count them according to the size of the diagram. So, my first goal is to try to obtain some combinatorial analysis of these diagrams and from a combinatorial point of view. So first of all, we fix a Boolean function in k variables. So during all my talk, k will be the number of variables. And a binary decision diagram is data structure that represents the Boolean function f that is represented as a DAG, a directed acyclic graph, that is compact. It's a compact form of the representation of f, and in fact, it is used in order to evaluate the function efficiently. So, if you are looking to my decision diagrams here, in fact, if I want to evaluate f for a specific evaluation of the variables, I can go from the root here to the value of the function by looking to a specific path. For example, if I evaluate my variable x4 to false, then I am going to the leftmost child of x4, so the one with the dotted edge. And then if I evaluate x3 to true, then I am using the solid edge to go in deeper in my diagram. And then if I, for example, take x2 to be true, then I take second time the solid edge, and then whatever I reach my false value here. So whatever the value, the truth value of x1 is, my function is false in that case. Okay, so the efficiency of this representation for the evaluation is in fact relying on some divide and conquer principle. So for the literature, in 2000, Wegener wrote a big and nice monography about binary decision diagrams. And later in 2011, Knuth integrated in his volume 4 of The Art of Computer Programming a big section about decision diagrams. And there are some combinatorials studies or point of views about these diagrams, but there are no so much combinatorial study otherwise in the literature. And in fact, in this talk, I will be interested in a specific subclass of binary decision diagrams that are reduced ordered binary decision diagrams. So what means ordered? It means that if you are looking to a path from a root to any leaf of the diagram, then the variables that you met are always ordered in the same order. So on my example here, I'm starting from x4 and I am ending at x1 for a decreasing order of the index. And the fact that the diagram is reduced means that inside my diagram, I have now two occurrences of the same substructure. Okay, so this means reduced. And from now, I will use the notation ROBDD, BDD for this structure. And as I told before, I am interested in the combinatorics about such diagrams. So one motivation about my work is the following. In two years ago, Newton and Verna worked in an analysis for the size of ROBDDs. In fact, one of their goals was to define for a given number of variables, here for example for four variables, the complete distribution of the sizes of the ROBDDs for function over four variables. So here in this picture, for example, they obtain that for four variables, there are among about 22,000 of function with ROBDDs of size 10. Okay. I just recall that there is a double exponential increasing here. When you are looking to four to function in four variables, you have 2^2 to the 4 functions. So you have about 65,000 of functions. And using their plot, we can see that all the ROBDDs of these functions are of size at most 11. And so they wanted to obtain this nice distribution for Boolean function from 1, 2, 4 and so on variables. And in fact, due to this increase, they managed to compute the complete distribution until k to be equal to 4. And then the number of functions in 5 variables is more than 4 billions, so they did not manage to obtain it exhaustively. So for the rest of their study, they did some extrapolation by sampling uniformly at random functions. In fact, they sampled the truth table of the function, and then they construct using the truth table the ROBDD, and so they got for a uniform generation of function the value, the size of the ROBDDs. And in fact, for 9 and 10 variables, they obtained such kind of extrapolation, where we see that finally, according to their experiments, almost all functions have a very big size for their ROBDD, and in fact, the maximal size that is possible. Okay, and as you can see on their extrapolation, they are not able, by sampling uniformly functions at random, to obtain ROBDDs of small sizes. Okay, there is no point from the range 20 to 100, for example, for 9 variables, or for the size 20 to 200 for the functions over 10 variables. But in fact, we know that there are many interesting functions that have ROBDDs of small size. For example, the ROBDDs that allows to make an addition, or functions that are read once or symmetric have ROBDDs of size k squared. So for example, if you are interested in threshold function or in the majority function, in blue here, you have the size of the ROBDD of the majority function. The last line corresponds, to 10 variables. If you want to, in fact, for 10 variables, the majority functions ROBDDs are sized 32. So the majority function is somewhere here or here. So by sampling randomly and uniformly Boolean function, there is no chance to attempt the majority function, by example. So my goal is to be able to sample by choosing a size, for example, a size 100 for 10 variables, to be able to sample ROB disease uniformly at random here for with size 100. Of course, we know that there are other functions that are interesting and whose ROB disease is large, but I am not interested in that direction for the moment. Okay, and now I will just try to give you an intuition why the enumeration of ROB disease is hard. Okay, so I have depicted here one ROBDD for a function in 9 variables, and I use GraphViz to obtain my representation. But as you see, GraphViz try to obtain some kind of compact representation, and so the edges are all tangled. So I first want to untangle a little bit these edges in order to see the structure of my ROBDD a bit better. So I just put the left child and the right child a bit away in order to be able to see, to focus on the left, on the left child of my diagram and the right child of my diagram. Okay, and between both of them, you can see there are some red edges. This is just my point of view. I depicted the edges that are going from the right to the left by red edges. And now if you are focusing on the left diagram, in my point of view, in my representation, you remove the red pointer, then you can see that this is also a ROBDD over 8 variables. But of course, if you are looking to the right part of my diagram over 8 variables, this is no more a ROBDD because of these red edges. This is not a closed form. This is not a closed diagram. You need these red edges to construct it completely. And this is one of the reasons why the enumeration of diagrams is hard. Okay, but we will try to do it. So this is the outline of my talk. So first of all, I will give you some combinatorial preliminaries in order to understand the way I will enumerate the structure later. Once we will be able to see my combinatorial point of view, we will be able to give the recursive counting for ROBDDs. And once we have the recursive counting, we will be able to give some kind of unranking algorithm in order either to sample exhaustively ROBDDs, but as the number is increasing so fast, exhaustive generation is out of order, is not possible. But you can also use my unranking algorithm in order to use it as a uniform sampler, taking two parameters, the number of variables of the function and the size of the ROBDDs you want. Okay, so first of all, binary decision diagrams is built from a decision tree. You know, a decision tree is a structure representing a Boolean function that is not so far from the truth table of the function. If you are looking here to my last level of the decision tree, in fact, it is some encoding of the truth table of the function. And how do you read this? As before, if you evaluate x4 to false, you are going to the left, to the dotted edge, you follow the dotted edge. x3 to true, you follow the plane, the solid edge. x2 to false, you saw the dotted edge, and x1 to false, the dotted edge. And so, for example, for this evaluation, the function evaluates to false. And in fact, the fact that you have dotted edges and solid edges gives some kind of order for the children of a node. Okay, I will say that the left child is obtained when you are following the dotted edge, and the right child is obtained when you are following the solid edge. And then, so this representation can be seen as a plane tree. Each node has two children that are ordered, the leftmost child and the rightmost child for this one. So using this convention, I can use the classical traversal of trees. For example, I can traverse this tree with the post-order traversal. So I am going to the left as most as possible, and then I'm going one step further, and so on. And during all the talk, the ordering of the variables goes from xk to x1. Xk at the root and x1 for the last level of internal nodes. So it's not the usual way to label the variables. Usually you have x1 here, x2 for the second level, and so on. But in fact, I want to obtain some recursive construction, so it's easier to take the larger variable at the root of the tree. And now, how do I obtain ROBDD? In fact, the ROBDD is a result of the compaction of the decision tree. You have two, for a given decision tree. So for example, for this one, you have two rules for compaction. First of all, you eliminate any node that has two identical children. Okay, so for example, here, x1 has two children that are both equal to true. So x1 will disappear. And if you are looking to the leftmost branch here, from x2, you are going directly to the leaf, to the sink of the diagram. So x1 has disappeared here. And the second rule is the following. If you have two identical subtrees in the structure, you remove the second occurrence and you replace it by a pointer to the first one. So for example, if you are looking here and here, this x1 false true, that is here, x1 false true is a right child of this x2, but also it's the right child of this x2 here, x1 false true. So this substructure is replaced by a pointer to this one, okay, as you can see here. And now, in order to obtain the ROBDD, I use this both compaction rules until it is not possible to use them anymore. And we can prove that the system of rules is confluent. So whatever the order you apply the rules, you obtain the same structure at the end when you are not able to compact it anymore. And one consequence of this is that the ROBDD is unique for a given function. In fact, it's clear that the decision tree is unique for a function because it is somehow the truth table of the function. And the most compacted form that you obtain using both this rule is consequently unique also. So the reduced order binary decision diagram has an interesting property, so such that for a given function, its structure is unique. And now, instead of using my compaction rules in any order, I am using the post-order traversal of my decision tree. So for I will start by following the leftmost branch of my decision tree, and here I am finding true for I am ending at true. It's the first time I see true, so I put in my compacted structure true, and then I'm going to the second leaf. I get true a second time. Okay, so I already seen true, so nothing else. When I want to compact X1, it has twice the same child, the same children, so X1 will be removed. So I go here, I met false. Okay, I put false here. I obtain true. I have ever seen true. And then X1 pointing to false and to true. So this is this one. X1 pointing to false and to true. I see it for the first time. And then I am looking to this X2, and it's pointing to true for the leftmost child, true, and to the previous substructure here for the rightmost child. And then you are using your post-order traversal in order to compact your decision tree. And in fact, this post-order traversal gives me some such point of view for representing my function. As you've seen, everything is put to the left in my tree and in my DAG. And once I obtain a second occurrence of a substructure, I obtain my red edges from before. Okay, so this is my representation of ROBDDs. And now I want to enumerate ROBDDs, but in fact, in order to do this, I will take a partition of the set of ROBDDs according to the black structure that remains here when you are removing the red edges. And this black structure is some kind of spanning tree, and I will call it the spine of a ROBDD. Okay? And so I am using this equivalent class relation, and I want now for a given spine to enumerate, to count how many ROBDDs are encoded by this spine. So I must, this is a combinatorial question. How can I add red edges in order to get a valid ROBDD? Okay, but let us try on this example. Okay, I will denote the weight of a spine to be the number of possibilities to add red edges to obtain a valid ROBDD. In fact, the weight of a spine is a multiplicative parameter, because once you have chosen one edge, you have to choose another red edge, and it's not independent, but of course it's a multiplication that you will do. Here I have some definitions, but we will see them on the example. So first of all, I have my spine here, and now I want to add the red edges. So the first element I am interested in is this X1. I must add it to it a left child and a right child. Of course, these children must, because I am interested in X1, these children belong to the both constant, true and false. So for the leftmost child, I have two possibilities, either true or false. And for the rightmost child, I have a single possibility, because X1 cannot point twice to the same child. So the number of possibilities to add two red edges here is 2 times 1. If I am looking to the red edge for this X2 here, this red edge must point here in the pool, either true or false, because it cannot point to something that has not been seen for the moment. So it cannot point to this x1, for example. So here the number of possibilities for this edge is 2. And you can continue here a bit more complicated. The red edges here, the leftmost child can be either the Bose constant, but it could also be this x1. So I have 3 possibilities so for the leftmost child, and for the rightmost one, I cannot point to the same as before. So it's only 2 possibilities, but there is another constraint here. I cannot define the same node here as this one, because I cannot have twice the same occurrences of a substructure in my global error BDD. So I must remove one possibility that is the same as this substructure rooted at this x2. So finally, the number of red edges for this x2 is 4. And I can continue. And when I am done with all the red edges, I have computed that this spine is encoded in fact 300 error BDDs. Okay, so there are 300 functions in 4 variables with this spine. Okay, the counting can be proved, and here are the 4 possibilities or for the weight of a node. Okay, I will not enter into details, but the example that you have seen is using all of these 4 rules. So now I am able to compute the weight of a spine. Okay, I compute the weight of each of its nodes, and then the weight of the spine is the product of the weights of its nodes. And if I am with this, I am able to enumerate the error BDDs according to the size of the error BDDs, because the size of the spine is exactly the same as the size of the error BDD. But I can improve my construction. So my first equivalence relation was to replace error BDDs by spines. And in fact, as you have seen in my formula just before, the way the structure is constructed is not important, because in my formula here I have just numbers. Okay, the substructure here of the spine is not important. So in fact, what is important is the number of nodes of a given level. So I have 1x3 on the leftmost side, I have 2x2 on the leftmost side, I have 1x1 of the leftmost side, and I have the 2 constants. And the structure here is not important. So I take a second equivalence relation, putting the spine into pool spines where the leftmost child is reduced to an integer vector. And uses the second both equivalent relation, I am now able to enumerate the error BDDs according to their size. And for Boolean function over k variable, I can obtain the complete distribution of the error BDD size with an algorithm of this order of complexity. So this the important part here is 2 to the k squared. Okay, now this is exponential, of course, but in fact you must recall that the number of functions is 2 to the k. So this complexity is much smaller than the one that was used by Newton and Verna when they did their exhaustive counting. In practice, it is exponential, so we will not be able to manage a very huge k. So, for example, for k, we are able to compute the complete distribution for 8 variables in 2 hours of on my computer, for example, and with a Python implementation. If you are using a faster implementation in C++, we are able to reach k equals to 9 in 3 days computation. Okay. It remains some minutes, so this is some key ideas how to prove the complexity, but it's not so interesting now. So in fact, here I have in black my complete distribution, exact distribution that I have been able to compute. And if you are looking to details into the extrapolation of Newton and Verna, we see that the extrapolation were good because in fact everything is constrained in the errability of large sizes. But if you are looking in details here, I have the exact value. So I can use a logarithmic scale, and for example, for 9 variables, errobilities of size 60 are of order 2 to the 300. And this is peanuts in front of errobilities of size 130 that are about 2 to the 500 and something. Okay, but I have the exact value for all the RBDD sizes. Okay, I take a few minutes to give the basic ideas to unrank RBDDs. So just recall, the unranking method is some kind of exhaustive sampler. In fact, you define a total order for the structure you want to unrank, and then you pick a rank and you try to construct the object associated to this rank, but of course not by constructing all the other structures. So for example, here I am just looking to binary trees whose size are counting by the number of internal nodes. So for example, trees of size 1, you have 1, so its rank is 0. Trees of size 2, you have 2. I choose this total order, so I put this one related to the rank 0 and this one related to rank 1. And for X3, for three internal nodes, you have 5 trees, and I choose this order. In fact, this order is related to this decomposition. For a tree of size n plus 1, I decompose it as a left child of size n and a right child of size 0, and so on. And when you want to unrank a tree of size n plus 1, you define first the size of the left child and then the size of the right child. So for example, I am interested in trees of size 7, and I know using Catalan numbers that those trees are of order approximately 400 trees in that size. Okay, I want to unrank the tree of with rank 250. Okay, so I decompose my 429 in the size decomposition. So you have size 6 on the left and size 0 on the right, size 6 on the left and size 1 on the right, and so on. And if you are looking to rank 250, in fact you see that 250 is between 227 and 255. So you know that your tree is of this decomposition. So the size of the leftmost child is 2 and the size of the rightmost child is 4. And now you are computing the relative rank inside this decomposition. So the relative rank is 250 minus 227. And you want to define the rank of the leftmost child and the rank of the rightmost chunk. So you just use some division, integer division. So I divide by 14 because of this 14, and I obtain rank 1 for the left child, and the rest of the division is the rank for the right child. And now I am able to apply my unranking method recursively. I know that I must choose the rank 1 for a tree of size 2 and the rank 9 for a tree of size 4 for the left and right child. So I can obtain recursively my tree. But in our context, the both children are not independent because of the red pointers. So we are able to adapt the unranking methods in ArrowBDDs by taking care of this. In fact, I just give some intuition. In fact, I will unrank my ArrowBDDs through the post-order traversal. So I must first define the left child, and then I will be able to construct the right child. But in fact, both calls will not be independent. I must first define this substructure before be able to construct this one. And in fact, I will finish with this. For example, if you are looking to this small ArrowBDDs of with two variables of size 5, its rank is 0. Okay. If you are looking to the left child here, it is this one. Relatively, this one is of rank 0. But here, the second child is this one. This one is of rank 1. But once you have construct the leftmost child, then the rightmost child rank is not 1, because in fact, you have a single possibility for a tree enrooted at x1 here, because you cannot build a second times the leftmost one. So the both calls here for the leftmost and the rightmost one will be with the ranks 0, but of course you cannot build twice the same child. So you must be careful to this in the construction. And in fact, our approach can adapt to other kinds of BDDs. Here you have some examples. We are able to improve the construction by using some extension of work on compacted binary trees by Andrew Wanzi and Michael, they obtain the result using, instead of looking to a bottom-up, to a decomposition from the root to the leaves, decomposition of the tree, they use some kind of enriched dig path. And we are able to improve our approach by using their adaptation. And in fact, if we want to obtain a size decomposition for functions with a higher number of variables, we must be able to find another way to compute them, because as you have seen, our method is still exponential in the number of variables, so the counting method cannot be actual counting method cannot be improved in order to obtain a bigger function with a big number of variables. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Maybe you can applause and ask for questions. Sergei? No? Wants to ask the first question?
I have one question.
But related to slide 8, maybe can you move to slide 8, Antoine? It's about the two rules.
Yes.
Transform a decision tree into ROBDD. Have you some combinatorial study about the number of different paths leading going from a decision diagram to ROBDD? Rewriting for paths in terms of rewriting.
I don't think that such. I have no work. I didn't work in this direction, and I have no idea if there are some results in the literature. I don't know.
And do you have an idea
what is the effect on 8 of each rule?
It's contextual.
I guess so. So it has no meaning. It depends on the starting point.
Okay. Yes. I
but maybe know. It's another way of representing ROBDD implicitly by a decision diagram plus a path or a set of paths from it to the ROBDD. I don't know if it can lead to a combinatorial results.
Okay, yes, I do understand your comment. Thank you.
Another question?
Yes, Pierre.
Pascal. Yes.
Yes, when you presented the unranking method, obviously it's recursive, but you didn't give a code or a presentation which is recursive. Like, for instance, a code in Haskell. Did you try to program that in Haskell or in a recursive language and to see how the what your specific approach for ROBDD means when you work on messaging or transforming the Haskell code?
In fact, now we have used some kind of imperative program. So we have a Python and a C++ implementation, but we have not tried to obtain some kind of functional program to derive our ROBDD. So
because, you know, I have the feeling that if I may agree, which is debatable, that the C++ code is faster, but I have the feeling that if you work first with a real recursive presentation, you can see how you can transform it and message it. Yeah, okay, that's just a suggestion.
Okay, thank you.